sure to fade.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Jason Womack from Ben Ray, Fuel, and Juliet and the Licks, and you are listening to Blevins Nation.
Blevins Nation Entertainment and BlevinsNation.com, the place to go for all the best in rock and roll music, new rock, and podcasts. So sit back, hold tight, and open up your ears. The revolution is here. Now here's your host, Chris.
She was brand 17 and rides a crazy ghost. She can win the hearts of a man. She's done. Smiling all the while she's thinking that she never got it.
Hey everybody, this is Chris with Blevins Nation, and we're talking with Jason Womack, guitar player for Fuel and Veray. Is that right? Vinray. And Juliet and the Licks. Wow. That's right.
I actually played bass with Juliet, yeah.
Oh, you played bass with Juliet. Okay. Hi.
Yeah.
Well, damn, that's quite a lineup there, you know.
I usually end up those shows on guitar though, because we do a little thing where we do a drum circle and we all switch instruments. So I end the show on guitar after playing some drums for a minute. But
right.
Yeah, it's a good time.
There you go. Well, hell yeah, man. That's cool. Now, Jason, you're from where in Mississippi? Jackson. Okay.
Jackson. That's right.
All right. So. So you know a little bit about everything from there, JCLs and the Creek and all that good stuff.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I used to play at the Creek all the time with my band, Vandeveer.
Really? You were in Vandeveer? Okay. Now, was that when they had two bass players?
Yep. Justin Rich and Robert Henney.
Yes, I love Justin. Justin's my buddy.
And then there was, Justin's awesome, man. And then there was Roger Corley, and Leo Lopez was the drummer, God rest his soul. And Dewey Bragg was the vocalist.
Okay. Dewey sang with them with Southern Grunge. That's right. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Southern Grunge and Brick.
Yes. Okay. Right.
Yeah, before that, Vandeveer and Charade, we used to play together at the Creek quite a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, well, when we first started doing Vandeveer, I was only 16 years old and Dewey was 15.
Oh, good God.
So we weren't even really old enough to be there, you know. But
oh man, that's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that was the Creek, man. I mean, shit, you know, half the audience wasn't 18 yet, but.
I know, right?
I know I wasn't for a couple of years, so, cool. So what took you out to L.A.?
Music.
I hear you.
Plain and simple, yeah. You know, I mean, it's funny. I tell people out here all the time that I know some of the most amazing musicians from Mississippi, but no one will ever hear of them because there's just no industry there. As much of a musical place it is.
Yeah.
You know, pretty much everybody I know either, you know, moved out to L.A. or moved to Austin or, you know, some to Nashville. It's become a little more rock friendly.
Right.
That's exactly why I came out here. I put everything I owned in a trailer and I'd never even been here before, man. I was just like, fuck it. I can always go back if I want, if I don't like it.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I had my biggest dream was at 15 to just go and head out. But,
yeah.
Of course, that never happened, unfortunately. But
I came out here in 1997 and just never looked back.
97. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, how old were you then?
Oh, God. About 24.
Okay. All right. So you're three years younger than me. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Well, that's cool, man. I tell people that all the time because the older I got, I was like, I'm not going to go to LA and ever do shit. So, and I told all these young cats, man, that were good. If you want to go somewhere, go to LA, you know, and they're still in freaking Pearl or Brandon, not doing shit, you know, but,
It's hard. I mean, it's definitely very expensive to live out here now, you know?
Yeah. Well, everybody's scared to uproot, you know, and they're like, their biggest thing is there's way more musicians out there. Well, hell yeah, that makes you better, you know? That makes you want to get better, you know? Here, you're just sitting there doing nothing because nobody's coming to see you. I'm sorry, you know?
I mean, it's definitely a competitive scene out here, but it's gotten kind of interesting with, I don't know if you've ever heard of the Soundcheck Live event.
No, I've heard of Ultimate Jam, but not the Soundcheck, yeah.
Okay, yeah, Ultimate Jam and Soundcheck Live actually were originally the same thing, and they splintered off into two different nights.
Okay.
And but Soundcheck Live, I've played both of those events quite a few times, and it's really interesting. They basically just send you, say, like, okay, you're going to learn these two or three songs on guitar, and you just show up and you play them with a group of other people that were sent these songs. You don't even know each other most of the time. You never rehearse, nothing. You just get up there. That's why it's called Soundcheck Live.
So that's,
and you just get up there and pull it off.
So that's
which
how
is really
that works.
Kind of a blast, you know?
Yeah. I didn't know that that's how that worked. I thought you got together with them beforehand and were like, hey, let's do this song, or do you know this song, blah, blah, blah. That's very...
No, not at all. That's what makes it kind of interesting and dangerous, you know.
No,
you just get up
shit.
There and like with a group of sort of all star quote unquote other musicians, you know, and you just get up there and just do it. It's a blast.
Yeah, yeah, that's cool. Because Daryl had told me back years ago when he was out there that they had a thing called similar to karaoke, but it was the band knew all the songs and people just got up and performed with them, you know.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Totally.
Okay. But this is very cool. I like that. That's, man. So I guess you know, is it Brandon Paul?
Yeah, from Stonebridge?
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't really know him that well. I know Carlos pretty well. And
okay.
Vin Ray has actually played quite a few shows with Stonebridge before.
Yeah, I've seen that before online, so.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I just knew Brandon goes out there a lot and plays on, I think it's Tuesday nights or something. So.
Yeah. 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 Another cool thing that I've been a part of quite a few times is called the Rock Against MS show.
Yes.
And this girl, her name is Nancy Sale, and she was like a publicist for a bunch of bands like Jane's Addiction and Guns N' Roses. And but anyway, she's was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis years back.
Mm-hmm.
And so she started this foundation, Rock Against MS, and every year she puts on a big concert. And so, you know, like I went and played a couple of AC/DC songs. I got to play with Bill Burr, which was kind of cool. You know, the comedian?
Bill Burr. Yes. Okay. Yeah.
You know, Bill Burr, redheaded comedian.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyway, he does that show F is for Family on Netflix, and he was on Chappelle's show, and just a really, really funny guy. And it's kind of a similar thing with that, where she just puts together an all-star group of people. You learn the song, you get up there and jam it, you know, for charity.
Okay.
That's great.
Yeah, I know. I think Jack Russell's done that a couple times.
Yep. Yeah, he did it last year, actually. That's right.
Right.
And also Stephen Perkins got up and was playing with us this last time from Jane's Addiction, which was really cool.
Oh, okay. I know Ace Von Johnson.
Yeah, yeah, Ace was there this last time.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
That was just
there.
Like, what, two or 3 weeks ago, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay. Him and Johnny Martin were both there, you know, from LA Guns.
Oh, okay. All right, bass player. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
That's right.
Very cool. Yeah, they just came through here a couple weeks ago. And
what is it? Mark Torian in the Bold Boys? Am I pronouncing that right?
Yeah, Mark Torian. Yes, he was there.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, he was there. He sang some songs, and Marky Ramone and his band, Marky Ramone's Blitzkrieg, played a set.
Oh, okay. Well, heck
and,
yeah.
Yeah, it was a blast. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's
I've done
awesome.
It most years. Me and the guys that do Juliet and the Licks together,
mm-hmm.
The Licks, if you will, we started a cover band a long time ago called Petty Cash, where we do Tom Petty and Johnny Cash songs.
Oh, really? Okay.
So we get together and do like special events with that sometimes. And, you know, we've done the Rock Against MS Festival together a lot. And But it's difficult to get together sometimes because Todd, who plays guitar in Juliet and the Lakes, he's also plays in the Offspring. And me and Phil, the bass player, are doing Fuel.
Yeah.
And then Kimball, one of the other guitar players from the Lakes, he has his band called Ages. It's really awesome.
Yes, I just interviewed him a few weeks back.
That's right. I remember seeing that. Yeah. Kimball's a great guy, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very cool.
Yeah. So me and Kimball and Todd basically were the licks, if you will, back in the day. And so we did the record with Juliet called Fool on the Floor. And actually, Dave Grohl played the drums on that record.
No shit.
Yeah.
That is awesome.
So we had, it was cool. I joined Juliet's band in 2005.
Mm-hmm.
And we did Reading and Leeds Festival that year over in England.
Man.
And the Foo Fighters were on as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we ended up going and hanging out with those guys and meeting them. We ran into them a couple times after that. And then by the end of the year, Juliet and our drummer were not getting along, so she fired him. And was just happened to be talking to Dave and was like, man, I got to find a new drummer. We're writing songs. We got to do a record, all this stuff. And he was like, well, why don't you guys just come into my studio and I'll play drums for you and I'll help you get going. And we were like, yeah.
So y'all went to 606 and recorded?
Yeah, that's right. We went into 606 for a few days and did some songs. And after that, Dave was like, all right, well, look, I've got these dates blocked. I've got these dates open here. If you guys can do it, I'll just play on the whole record for you. So we were like, hell yeah. So we scrambled to get some songs written and get our shit together. And then we went into Henson Studios, which is where they recorded We Are the World.
Yeah.
You know, back in the day.
Uh-huh.
It's the old A&M studios. It's called Henson. It's Jim Henson's studio.
Okay.
Anyway, we went in there and finished the record with him. But got to play basically live in the studio with Dave Grohl for, a good solid week.
Man.
Which was awesome.
That's awesome. Wow. As you can tell, I'm a fucking Dave Grohl fanatic. He's just
everything that's cool bitch touch.
Oh hell yeah, I'm sure. I figured he was. You see these things and he seems like the coolest guy, but you just never know. So until you actually meet him. But
I saw him a few weeks ago. He was barbecuing at Rita Dimebag's girl Rita's party. She had a party in her backyard. He brought out his big smoker and was like barbecuing for everybody.
I saw a picture of that on something. I don't remember if it was Instagram or Facebook or what, but yeah.
Yeah, that's kind of his thing now. I think we had some really bad wildfires out here too, and he actually took his smoker. He took his smoker out there and was cooking for the firefighters.
Oh, that's what I saw. That's what I saw. Not the party. It was for the firefighters. That's right.
Yeah, that was actually like 2 days later after the party that I saw him at. That he was out there doing that. It's like, damn.
Yeah. He seems like a genuine guy.
He's a great guy now.
That's cool. Now, so Juliet and the Licks. And Vin Ray, got that right that time.
That's right.
And so what's Vin Ray doing?
We're actually playing tonight out at Petey's Place in the Valley. We got a show with, you remember that band Sponge?
Yes. I've never met them, but I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, we're playing a show with those guys in May at the Whiskey.
Okay.
And we've gone out, we toured with Alice Cooper, we toured with Slash, we toured with Buck Cherry and Hardcore Superstar.
Okay.
Just plugging along, man. We've done, the first album I don't really consider a Vin Ray record. So we've done really like four records together of that. And then we have another project called Godshot that's a bit more experimental, a bit more psychedelic.
Okay.
And always writing tunes. Me and Stephen Beret.
Okay. All right. Now, what about, so didn't y'all do an album last year?
Yep.
I was thinking so.
We did.
I think I remember seeing something.
We're completely independent. So, I mean, we made up some CDs of it and stuff, but we might still try to do a proper release at some point.
Okay.
Because basically we have our own label called Monarch Music Group. And so we're completely independently funded and so it makes it a bit difficult sometimes that way, but that's just the way you got to do it sometimes.
Oh yeah. Yeah, definitely. Now is it all digital?
Yep. Yeah. It's available definitely on iTunes. I know we're on Pandora and Spotify, all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
Which now, we don't see any money from.
Yeah, unfortunately. You know, you can't live off a 0.009 cents of fucking download, but, you know, whatever.
That's
a whole nother subject. So
it certainly is.
Now, what about Juliet and the Licks? Is that on digital release too?
Yeah, should be available everywhere, I would imagine. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, we got together back in September and did a little run of shows together. You know, it's kind of difficult with Juliet's schedule. She's been doing a lot of different acting gigs and stuff lately, and so sometimes whenever she has a bit of time off, she'll call us all up and be like, "Hey, you guys want to get together and do some shows?" You know, we try to make it happen if everybody's schedule permits.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Very cool. Fuel. I mean, wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big one there. I'm a huge Fuel fan. Love Brett.
Oh, cool. Nice.
Used to cover Shimmer back in the day.
All right, yeah.
Yeah, so, but hell yeah. Now, so when did you join Fuel?
About 3 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah, we had, back in 2012 or so, Vinray, we did a couple of tours opening up for Fuel. And then my friend Phil Buckman, who he's also in that Hired Gun documentary. Have you seen that?
No, and I keep telling myself I want to, and I keep forgetting about it. But it's on. Netflix.
I think it was on Netflix. Yeah,
right.
It'll definitely give you some insight into what musicians go through out here in LA.
Okay.
But my friend Phil Buckman, who plays Fuel with me now, and he also plays in Petty Cash. He was the bass player for Filter for a little while as well.
Okay.
And so Filter was on a tour with Fuel, and so when Phil quit Filter, he joined up with Fuel. And about four years ago, he hit me up to see if I could, you know, come in and join Fuel. And I had some other tours to do, and so I just couldn't do it. Didn't work out for my schedule.
Yeah.
But then a few years back, he called, and I had some open time, so I was like, sure, let's do it. You know, and I've been jamming with him ever since.
Man, that's cool. That's awesome. A Hired Gun is just, I mean, did you ever see yourself doing that in Mississippi?
No.
Okay. I mean,
do you
do studio stuff too? I mean, are you, you know, Hired Gun for studio stuff?
Sometimes, yeah. I recorded a bunch of stuff for this guy, Seth Hartman, and I'm definitely open to do that kind of stuff, but, you know, I travel so much nowadays that I'm just gone a lot, you know, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. You know, I mean, LA is a huge place, but sometimes everybody, you know, especially when it comes to musicians, a lot of you know each other. So.
Yeah, and that's the cool thing, kind of what I was talking about, the Soundcheck Live and the Ultimate Jam Night stuff, is that it's an opportunity to meet a lot of these other guys and sometimes get to jam with them. You know, it's a great thing.
Right. And you know, I hear that a lot with people, you know, musicians. I mean, they go out on the road in support of another band. And then the next thing you know, they end up getting a gig for playing with the band that they were in support of on the tour, you know?
Yeah, that's right.
Like you said, with the Fuel thing. So,
yeah, well, that's, you know, personality is a big part of touring with people. Obviously, you have to have the ability, you know, and the talent to pull off the gig. But personality is at least half of the coin, you know, too, to be able to travel and put up with people for extended periods of time, you know?
Oh yeah. And you got to make a good impression on somebody, you know, not just with, like you said, not just with your, you know, your, playability or whatever you want to call it, but, musicianship, but with your attitude, with everything else, you know, like you said, your personality, you know, but like you said, there is more competition in LA, way more competition than you would say Jackson, Mississippi. But the cool thing is, though, there's way more opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Don't you think? I mean, opportunity comes knocking. I wouldn't say not for everybody, like, you know, but it's full circle. You have to have it all to get, you know, the call. But there's way more opportunity out there. You know,
totally.
Everybody's making me want to come out there, and I'm 49 and I'm too damn late, but So, any daggum way. But, well, cool, man. So, now, you've been with Fuel, you said 3 years now. Is Fuel going to put out anything new?
Yeah, Brett and Phil and myself have been kicking around some ideas. You know, Brett definitely wants to release something.
Okay.
And so I've been helping him out there a little bit. And, you know, nothing we're ready to go into the studio with yet or anything, but right. We got some demos done.
Okay. Okay. And, very cool.
Yeah.
All right. Now you said you just went and played a show or a few shows with Fuel. Are y'all hitting the road this summer? Or which band's hitting the road?
With people, you know, this year, it's all this weekend flight date stuff, you know?
Okay.
You know, fly out on a Thursday and come home on a Sunday kind of deal, you know?
Right, right.
A couple of summers ago, in 2017, we got in a bus and did a whole package tour with Dishwalla and Marcy Playground.
Oh, okay.
And so we were out all summer with them. And, you know, we'll ended up getting ticketed up. Sometimes we did some shows with Soul Asylum recently. And a couple of shows with Skid Row.
Okay.
And the Gin Blossoms, you know, that kind of thing.
Okay.
And Candlebox, played with them a bunch of times.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Cool.
And, it's kind of, you know, a lot of those, you'll see a lot of that stuff like the Summerland stuff. You'll see a lot of those sort of 90s and 2000 era bands sort of ticketing up together and going on tour because it's just, sometimes it's difficult to do it on your own for some of those bands, you know?
Oh, yeah. Definitely. Now, what about festivals? Are y'all hooked up on any festivals this year?
We're doing some kind of biker thing out near you somewhere in Ohio.
Is that in Sandusky?
I don't know, man.
Okay. I know they have one every year, a big one up in Sandusky, Ohio. So I thought that might be where it is. So, okay.
Yeah, I can't remember. Let me see if I can. We're playing one in Thibodaux in a couple of weeks down near New Orleans for some kind of fireman's thing that they put on there.
Oh, okay.
And doing Fremont Street in Vegas. You ever been out to Fremont Street?
Oh, no, never have made it to Vegas. So, unfortunately.
It's called the Wetz Ellen Motorcycle Festival in Van Hertz, Ohio.
Van Hertz, okay.
Van Hertz. Yeah.
Van Hurt, okay.
Wherever that is.
I don't know either. I've only been here 5 years, so still don't know where shit is.
Yeah, you freezing your ass off up there or what?
Man, the older I get, the colder I get. And I still wear shorts, but damn it, I got to have a big-ass jacket on.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not too bad. The wind blows, I get cold. If it's 0 degrees wind, I'm all right.
Ooh, yeah. That's the beauty of Los Angeles. It never really gets below 40 degrees here, you know.
Oh, yeah. And I've heard San Francisco is just phenomenal weather.
Yeah. It's pretty cold and windy up there, though, lots of the time. But, yeah, San Francisco's a beautiful town.
Okay, cool. I'm trying to get out there. I want to come visit at least, you know. So,
Man, there's so many great natural places to go out here, like, from L.A., you got 2 hours away, you've got Joshua Tree National Monument, which is an amazing desert environment. And then 5 hours north of here, you can go to the Sequoia National Forest to see the giant trees you can drive through and stuff. And,
yeah, the big red.
And just an amazing place. You know, that's just south of Yosemite, which is also up in there. And then on the other side of that, you got Death Valley.
Yep.
And it's just California's got some really amazing natural places to go and visit.
Oh, yeah. And I've always wanted to go and get on that damn highway that goes along the coast. What is it?
Oh, yeah, the PCH, Pacific Coast Highway, yeah.
Yeah, it's got a number, though. Is it 60?
It's one.
Oh, it's one. Okay, for some reason I'm thinking 66, Route 66. Where is
that? Route 66 does go through L.A., but I think it goes from here to, like, Colorado or something like that.
Oh, okay. All right, I was thinking that was the one. So it's Route 1.
Yeah, one, or the PCH is what it's called, Pacific Coast Highway.
Okay, all right, very cool. Now, your buddy, of course, you played with him, Mr. Dewey Bragg.
Yeah.
Jason, that is. I just saw a picture of you two together. Was that from the MS show? Or was
that was at Rock Against MS, yeah. He was playing out there as well.
Okay, yeah, I think he was playing with... oh God, Bill, or what's his name from Black Sabbath, wasn't he?
Bill Ward? Yeah, Bill Ward, yeah.
Oh, that's right, okay.
I think they're in the studio working on some stuff right now. It's called Day of Errors.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's...
that's a pretty amazing thing.
Oh, yeah, yeah, exactly. I love a lot of the stuff he does. Smoke Hollow, of course, Kill Devil Heal. Dang them. I think they're about to go back to the studio.
Me and Dewey used to have a really cool band called Drip Licorice out here in L.A. with Michael Bradford, who's also from Jackson.
Oh, okay.
And Jeff Fab, who now he plays drums for Black Label Society now.
All right.
I don't know if you ever heard of Jeff Fab. And he was, anyway, like, me and Dewey, basically me and Dewey started the band In This Moment with Maria. You know the band
really?
In This Moment?
Yeah.
Yeah, because Dewey and Maria were dating.
Okay.
And so he was encouraging her to sing, so I helped her record some demos. She plays piano and sings and stuff. And so then Dewey had been in a band with Chris Holworth at the time, and then me and Dewey and Jeff were doing the Drip Licorice thing. We used to rehearse at Chris's place. And so we told Chris into coming and jamming with her Maria, and the original name of the band was called Dying Star.
Okay.
And we did a couple of shows together, right? We played like at the Troubadour with that band Crisis. You remember them?
Sounds familiar, not sure.
Yeah, anyway, you know, so some weird shit went down. Jeff ended up joining Dying Star, and then I ended up quitting and joining Juliet's band. And then they hooked up with Glasgow and got signed to Century Media, and they're doing great now, you know?
Yeah.
Chris Holworth, you know, is the main guitar player. He's a really great guy.
Mm-hmm.
And couldn't be happier for him, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome. Funny how things happen, you know? So, you know, and it happened that way back in the 80s too in LA. You know, you had, you know, for instance, Dokken and Rat, the bass players pretty much switched after the first albums, you know.
Right.
So, you know, that should happen.
It's an incestuous business.
It is. You know, and to be in Metallica and then turn around and get kicked out and then start your own, but I mean, it's just, you know, of course I'm talking about Dave, but I mean, Megadeth,
right.
You know, shit, man. LA is just, I'm sorry, it's just the greatest place on earth, I think, but I hope hopefully I'll get to see it one day.
It's a trip out here, man. Like, you know, I don't know, my favorite parts of LA aren't really what you would typically consider LA. I like the East Side. It's just got a lot more character, kind of, and you know, I end up going down and playing on the Strip a lot, you know, down at the Viper Room and the Whiskey, and, you know, obviously you can go up to the Rainbow and hang out, you know, and those places are cool and all, but, you know, it's definitely, people are nostalgic for that time of the 80s, you know, where which I've heard some stories about the debauchery that went on down there, you know. It's definitely, like a lot of places, like Times Square, you know, like Vegas, it's kind of been cleaned up and homogenized a bit, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And there's, you know, not really a scene in LA. There's no music scene.
I know.
I mean, there's a million shows going on every night, but people come and they show up to see their one band and they leave. You know, it's not like people make a night of it, hang out, watch all the bands and stuff. I really miss that from Mississippi.
Yes.
Because we would, you know, we would put on our own shows and, you know, because I started that band Mr. Ed back there as well.
Oh, yeah.
Jackson. I don't know if you remember that.
Yes, I remember Mr. Ed. Yeah.
Yes, I started Mr. Ed around that time, and then, you know, I quit Vandeveer, and then me and Michael Bradford and Ryan Ferris started a band called Smile, which was, we used to play at W.C. Don's and at, you know, Midnight Sun and all those kind of places. And, we were playing for a minute there with Will from Flinghammer was playing some drums with us for a bit.
Oh, okay.
And you know, we used to rehearse down there on Capitol Street there by the railroad tracks.
Oh, yeah, where everybody did. You know Trent Mays?
Yeah, I know the name for sure.
Okay, he, gosh, he played with, was it Shane Turnage played guitar and somebody?
Yeah, me and Shane actually played in a couple of bands together back in the day.
That figures.
Yeah, I love Shane, man.
Yeah, I know all those cats, but yeah, Trent played in a band that practiced there. A lot of bands I knew practiced there. Can't remember.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun back then, man.
Oh, yeah.
You know, playing down there. And Billy Pleasant was in some bands with me down there back in the day. You remember Billy Pleasant?
That sounds familiar.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. He lives out in London now.
Oh, okay. You know Justin's out in London.
Yeah, I actually saw him. I was out there playing a couple of years ago, and he came out to the club and hung out with us.
Oh, that's awesome. That's cool. He was in town last year for a few months, and he's back now. So, but
nice.
Well, that's cool, man. That hasn't been that way in LA in a long time. I hear that now it's all cover bands, tribute bands, you know. I'm not going to sit here and knock them, but
There's a lot of tribute bands, but there's you know, a million original bands as well, you know.
Okay. I'm just saying, but it's hard to find, you know, find them playing out is what I've heard. I don't know that for sure, you know.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, how it is. I mean, just like Jackson, they want to hire a cover band because, well, now.
You know, most of the bands playing in clubs in L.A. are original bands. There's not really a lot of cover band scene unless it's like specifically a tribute night or something.
Oh, okay. Okay.
You know what I mean?
All right. So it's
It's like, you know, how many times can you go and listen to a band play fucking Man in the Box? You know what I mean? I love that song, but it's like, you know, it just kills me. It seems like the cover band, these guys all play the same fucking song. You know what I mean?
Yeah. We tried to pick.
I'm not down on it, you know?
Yeah, I know. We always tried to pick obscure shit, you know? We'd play, you know, but we were half original, half cover, just cause so we could play a whole gig, you know? And,
right.
You know, we did Needle in a Spoon by Lynyrd Skynyrd, you know?
Okay.
Dirty Deeds, Motor by Circus of Power. You know, I mean, we did shit that not a lot of people did. So,
right.
And did Zombie by the Cranberries way the fuck before anybody else did and got popular with it. But that's just me. But so, not knocking their song, but it's cool. Well, yeah, man. So now where can everybody check all the bands out? I mean, of course, Fuel's on, you know, Facebook. What about Juliet and the Licks?
Man, I don't know if there's an official website up or not anymore. I haven't really looked in a number of years, to be honest with you.
Okay. But I mean,
you can always
Facebook?
Keep up with whatever. Yeah. Juliet's on Instagram. That's kind of her main platform.
Okay. All right.
Where she communicates with people. She has a Facebook page as well, but she's definitely on Instagram a lot more than Facebook. And she's on there a lot, man, doing her thing. She's funny, man, always doing her improv and her little skits and whatnot.
Yeah.
She's a really cool chick, you know.
I saw the video
What?
Oh, I was saying I saw the video the other day. Y'all were playing somewhere, and she was out surfing the crowd, gone for like 2 or 3 minutes, and finally made it back.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, yeah. That was our show at the Terragram this past September, yeah.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah, that was great. Yeah, she's pretty wild, man. You know,
yeah.
I met her because, have you ever heard of the singer-songwriter named Joseph Arthur?
No.
He's an Ohio guy. I think he's from Akron or Cleveland or somewhere around that area.
Okay.
Anyway, really talented guy. He's actually out, he's doing a project right now with Peter Buck from REM called Arthur Buck.
Okay.
And anyway, so him and Juliet were dating, and you know, and I've known Joe for a number of years. And so that's kind of how I got hooked up with her. Like, they happened to be out having lunch together when her bass player quit on her right before a big tour.
Oh.
So, you know, he suggested me, and I went through, you know, went and they auditioned several other people and ended up offering me the gig, you know. And
that's cool.
What I thought was just going to be one tour turned into, you know, all this.
Yeah. You said, what, 2005 when you joined up with
Yeah.
them? Okay.
Yeah.
And you moved out there in 97, right?
That's right, yeah.
So what did you do between getting that? I mean...
Oh, man. My first job out here, I actually worked on the visual effects unit for Titanic, you know, the film.
Wow, no shit. Okay.
Yeah, I was a PA, which is kind of just the, you know, the lowest man on the totem pole. I'd never worked on a movie before, you know. So I worked on that for a good 6-7 months or so, which was brutal. The hours were just unbelievable.
I bet.
But yeah, I was on the visual effects unit, so we had like big, we were like smashing icebergs into models of the ship and, you know, green screen stuff, like weird stuff, you know. And So yeah, that was my first job. I did that for a while, and I was doing I was in post production for a bit. I used to do satellite feed. Okay. I did like the syndicated Seinfeld show, satellite feed, and I don't know. I used to do the MTV making of the video feeds, and like, you know, I didn't even really play in a band for a while. Actually, Billy and I used to do a lot of DJing when I first moved out here. I kind of like in the late 90s, I didn't even play my guitar for almost a year. I got like, I went down the rabbit hole of listening to a lot of trip hop and a lot of electronic music.
Okay.
And Billy and I would do a lot of DJing and programming music and stuff like that. Also DJing a lot of funk and soul, like Old Brothers Johnson, shit like that. So we did that stuff for a while, and then we started a band, kind of a hybrid of like rock and electronic, you know. Yeah, but it's just, you know how it is. Starting bands and keeping a band together is fucking heartbreaking, man. It's so hard to do. And you put all this time and effort into something, and one guy decides he doesn't want to do it anymore. And, you know, it's just, it's such a pain in the ass.
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, that's the hardest part of a band is finding three or four guys that have the same exact, I don't mean same exact everything, but same exact dream and
yeah,
and especially work ethic. Holy shit, that's the even harder.
and let's say you even find that, right? And then you have to sustain it for years. You know, like, which rarely happens.
Oh yeah.
Definitely. As everyone who's had bands knows, it's heartbreaking, man.
It is. It is. And I'm sure, even like you said with the in this moment thing, I mean, I'm sure that was still heartbreaking after that happened. I mean, maybe not, but a little discouraging. Like, damn, I was in that, you know. Or
no, I'm fine with how that all went down. You know, honestly.
Now, so what's the future look like? Any?
Well, just, you know, we're just traveling most of the time to pay the bills. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah.
As a musician, you know, there's not, you know, not a whole lot coming in from BMI, you know, so you're basically out there, or ASCAP or whichever one you're on, you know, so you're pretty much out there, you know, traveling for your supper, you know, literally.
I mean, I bet from what I've heard, merch has a lot to do with getting you to the next town sometimes.
Absolutely. Yeah. And Vinray, we're going to be out in New York in June.
Okay.
Playing some shows around there. And fuel's kind of, you know, flight eights in and out all the time. And as far as the licks, I don't know. We'll see when Juliet's got a little time off and I put something together,
Okay. All right. Well, very cool. So now, is that Vin Ray that's going to be out in L.A.?
New York.
LA. Shit, yeah. New York? Yeah. Okay. Very cool.
That's right.
All right.
Yeah, and then Petty Cash, we're playing in May. We're going to be playing out at Alicia Moore's house. You know Pink, the artist?
Yes.
Yeah, so she's a good friend of ours, and she comes out and sings with us lots of times when we play. And
beautiful.
You know, we've known her for a long time.
Amazing.
So she bought a winery out in Santa Barbara that she lives on. And they haven't released any wine to the market yet. They're still kind of just playing around.
Mm-hmm.
And she lived out there with her husband, Kerry Hart. And every year they have a big camp out on their property. They got a lake out there with like a beach around it. And so every year they have a big camp out and they just invite all their friends and family to come out, set up tents and just hang out for the weekend, you know? And we're going to go out there and set up and do a Petty Cash show out there. And,
nice.
You know, she has food trucks and ice cream trucks come driving out there and serve everybody. And she's just a really, really sweet person.
That's awesome.
Just, you know, it's amazing because she's like one of the biggest pop stars in the world, but you would never know it when you're hanging out with it.
Okay. Well, hell yeah, man. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, cool, man. So, can't wait for the date here. I got to look that up and see where that is in Ohio. And, definitely, man. Well, cool. I guess we'll get off of here. We've been on for a little while, but, good luck with everything, you know. And
yeah, man, you too. Good luck with the podcast as well. You know?
Hey, appreciate it, man. Appreciate it. So,
cool thing.
Well, that wraps up this week's episode of Blevins Nation. That's right, BlevinsNation.com. Check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and all of the download sites, Spotify,
iHeartRadio, iTunes, you know, Google Play, Stitcher, FM Player, all those places. And definitely on iHeartRadio and get us moving up the charts there. That's very cool. I want to thank Jason Womack for coming on the show and talking about his past, present, and future. And good luck to him and all his endeavors. And everybody check out Fuel, Vin Ray, and Juliet and the Licks. So everybody stay tuned for next week's podcast. And that's going to feature Mr. Frank. Well, I'll just leave it at that. So peace out. And remember, kids, wherever you go, there you are.